Hello, I'm Jesse Burbank, a member of the Dole Institute Student Advisory Board. Welcome to the Dole Institute of Politics, and thank you for being with us. The Dole Student Advisory Board is composed of KU students committed to the bipartisan mission of the Dole Institute. Members of the SAB receive opportunities to network with guests and preference when applying for our internship assistance or for paid student positions at the Institute. If you are a student and would like to get involved, please contact us. The Dole Institute would like to hear from you. If you enjoy this afternoon's program, please let us know by contacting us on Facebook, Twitter, or through our website's email. Our past and future programs are available to watch on video on our website. We'd like to encourage each of you to become friends of the Dole Institute. Do so by returning the brochure on your chair at the end of tonight's program. Our friends help keep our programs free and open and support archive research and our student activities. I'd like to remind you to please turn off your cell phones. After the interview, we'll have some brief time for audience questions and answers. If you have a question, please raise your hand and a student helper with a microphone will come to you. Please ask just one brief question. Hearing assistance is available, and we have a loop section at each program designated by a sign. If you have any questions about the loop, or if at any time have difficulty hearing during the program, please alert one of our staff members or student volunteers here in the hall, and they can assist. And now, please welcome Associate Director of the Dole Institute, Dr. Barbara Ballard.
Thank you, Jesse. I said it before, what a voice. Good afternoon and welcome to the Dole Institute of Politics at the University of Kansas. It is our pleasure to present, on his own terms, a life of Nelson Rockefeller with Richard Norton Smith. Before I introduce our speaker, though, I would just like you to ask you to turn to your program and look at upcoming events. East European Democracy and Russian Reemergence on December the 2nd, the Great American Wheat Harvest on December the 4th, and our very popular 2014 post-election conference, December the 11th, and you can see the rest. I think I'm looking at all 11 dates here. But anyway, we'll make sure that you're involved in the 2014 post-election and hope you will make time to come. It is my pleasure to introduce Richard Norton Smith, especially to those of you who may not have attended one of his programs before. Richard was the first director of the Dole Institute of Politics from 2001 to 2003. He has also headed up the Lincoln, the Hoover, the Eisenhower, the Ford, and the Reagan presidential libraries. He's a presidential historian. He's a frequent contributor to C-SPAN and PBS NewsHour. And as you know, Richard has revisited the Dole Institute many times. Most recently, he was here in February 2014 for a lecture on America's First Ladies. This afternoon, and you heard part of the conversation as they were waiting for us to start, Richard Norton Smith will discuss his newest biography on his own terms. And as you heard him say, he spent 14 years researching and writing this book. You will have the opportunity to buy the book and have Richard sign it after the program. I will turn the program over to Bill Lacey, director of the Dole Institute. But before I do, would you please give Richard Norton Smith a warm welcome back home.
Welcome back, Richard. It's great to have you here.
It's nice to be back.
Why did you feel it was so important to write this book?
Well, I can answer that personally, or I could answer that sort of professionally.
Why don't you answer it both ways?
Okay. I have a theory that you always start out writing biography, and you wind up writing autobiography, almost unwittingly. I was seven. I guess I first became aware of Nelson Rockefeller at the age of, this is even more bizarre than it sounds, six. The 1960 campaign, when he flirted seriously with challenging Richard Nixon for the Republican nomination. But in a sense, our relationship, which is what leads off the book, was crystallized on a night in July 1964 July 14th. The New York Times later called it Bastille Day in reverse, a none too friendly reference to the takeover of the Republican Party by the forces loyal to Barry Goldwater. And really, not since the 1912 Taft-TR battle had the party witnessed anything like this. First of all, it was a battle about ideas. It was historic in that sense. It became very personal, heightened certainly by the fact that many of Rockefeller's critics, although not, it's important to point out, Senator Goldwater, but many of his supporters used Rockefeller's divorce and remarriage to bolster their case that this, in effect, was a man not only philosophically, but morally unfit for the presidency. It was very clear long before the convention opened in San Francisco. Ironically, in the Cow Palace, the same building where 8 years earlier Republicans had met to renominate Dwight Eisenhower, who was about as different from Barry Goldwater as anyone could be. In any event, it was clear Goldwater had the votes. Goldwater had the platform. And most people would have sort of gracefully rolled over and said, okay, you know, we gave it our best shot. Now let's all come together. That was not Nelson Rockefeller. On his own terms, it's funny, I've been writing for 35 years. This is my 10th book. It is the first time I ever got the title I wanted. because I think even editors didn't have to have it explained to them that this was a man who lived his life and arguably died believing that, you know, he could even have death on his own terms. He certainly thought he could have the presidency on his own terms. And that night in San Francisco, anyone who ever saw it would never forget it. And so, of course, it was a preview. The Democrat, everyone remembers the Democrats in Chicago in 1968. And I always say the Republicans decided to act like Democrats 4 years early. The difference was they had their riot inside the hall instead of outside the hall. But both were in front of TV cameras. And, of course, TV in 1964 is a very different instrument. This was really the first convention that television made a huge difference. Enough so that the planners of the convention, faced with a liberal, for lack of a better word, revolt on the platform, did everything in their power to push it past midnight in the East. Because even then they had a sense that something could happen, and this was not some, the smaller the audience, the better for the campaign. Rockefeller chose to make his stand on the issue of political extremism, something that is not unfamiliar to our own generation. He had 5 minutes to speak for a platform plank, specifically denouncing the American Communist Party, the Ku Klux Klan, and the John Birch Society. Now, the moment he mentioned the Birchers, the place, of course, exploded. And you have to remember, three quarters of the people in that hall were not only for Goldwater, they were passionately for Goldwater. And equally important, three quarters of the people in that room hated Nelson Rockefeller's guts. And it wasn't just him they hated, although they certainly hated him. It's everything they thought he represented. The Eastern establishment, which election after election kept, in their view, robbing them of the nominee, who nominated people like Wilkie and Dewey and Eisenhower and Nixon, people who they thought could appeal to a broader electorate. Well, they were tired of appealing to a broader electorate. They thought that history had turned on a hinge in their direction. And for example, they looked at what was happening in the South with the signing of the Civil Rights Bill. And it was very clear overnight, almost, that the solid South, the old solid Democratic South, was suddenly up for play. And so clearly the Goldwater people thought if you could unite the South with the West and the usual Republican states here or there elsewhere, you'd have a new coalition. And that's what the convention was supposed to be all about. Well, Nelson Rockefeller spoiled it. He spoiled it by showing up. He spoiled it by getting up after midnight and starting in on a 5-minute speech, which, by the way, he had rehearsed earlier in the day. Over the years, there are people in the Go to War campaign who were convinced this was all set up, that Rockefeller knew what was going to happen and that he was taunting them from the beginning. He was not. He was before he was done. Because when the place went wild, there was a famous, there was a woman who stood up, a rather hefty woman who stood up on a chair down near the South Dakota delegation, and with leather lungs shouted out, "You lousy lover, you lousy lover," over and over again, which had little to do with extremism of a sort, but which on television multiplied by thousands of voices from very angry people, reinforced everything Rockefeller was saying about political extremism. You want to see political extremism? Here, we'll give you political extremism. Bailey Dierdorf, the crack political strategist, then both very young, both sadly since have passed away, and both of whom worked with Bob Dole in the 76 campaign, because they ran the Ford campaign. I talked to both of them, one of whom said, "It reminded me of a German Bund meeting in the 1930s, which is a pretty cruel thing to say, unless you've been there. In the hallway, in the aisle, like this, next to the Alabama delegation, which was strangely silent, because everyone else around them was shouting their anger, there was a tall, athletic black man who was shouting himself. He was shouting, "You tell him, Rocky, you tell him." What was Jackie Robinson? And Jackie Robinson was a Rockefeller Republican. But he was about the only one who was trying to offer support. So anyway, it was an amazing scene. And to the historian, it is remarkable because it's one of those very rare moments in history where you literally can see a page being turned. The Republican Party the next morning was not the party it had been. It might not know where it was going, but it knew it could never go back. And Nelson Rockefeller was the polarizing figure at the heart of all that. I watched it. I let my parents, I convinced my parents to let me stay up late that night. It was traumatizing to a 10-year-old would-be member of the Eastern establishment. of course, by that time, Rocky himself, who had a wonderfully mordant sense of humor, Stu Spencer, who ran the California campaign against Goldwater, and later, of course, became Ronald Reagan's, a legendary figure in the business, you know, and a wonderful, funny guy. Remind me to tell you my best Stu Spencer story later. But Spencer told me, at one point, the campaign was really in bad shape in California. They had all the money in the world and no volunteers. And he said, "You know, Governor, it's time to call in the Eastern establishment." And Rocky said, "Forget it, buddy. You're looking at all that's left." And he understood even then that he was something of an anachronism. But he was not going to roll over. Bill Scranton, recently deceased governor of Pennsylvania, who had stepped into the campaign to uphold the moderate cause. Dwight Eisenhower had been working on Scranton for days to get out of the race in the name of party unity. And he called Rockefeller on that morning and said, "You know, I'm going to get out." And Rocky and Ike were not buddies. And Rocky had no interest in party unity at that point. He said, "If you get out, then I'll get back in. Somebody has got to do the right thing." And to him, it was standing up, not just to Goldwater personally, nor even to Goldwater, quote, the extremist. You have to remember, at the heart of that campaign was civil rights. You know, the president had just signed the civil rights bill. Senator Goldwater, who was himself, I want to emphasize, no racist. On the contrary, he had taken the lead in desegregating the Arizona National Guard. But he also was of that strain of rugged individualism, what you and I today would call libertarianism, that believed the government did not have the right to force people to associate with one another. Well, Rockefeller came from a very different tradition. So again, it was a campaign about big ideas. And I think It's why it's probably one of the most colorful, substantive campaigns in history, and it's where I, in a sense, got my baptism and never quite got over it. And so it seems like the rest of my life, one way or the other, has been preparation for writing this book. And one other quick Kansas story. In 1989, I was asked by the National Archives at the Hoover Library then, and they asked me to do double duty because the Eisenhower Centenary was coming up the next year, and plans had not advanced terribly far in Abilene. So I was asked to run both libraries for a year and to put together an Eisenhower Centenary. And the guy named Jim Cannon, also recently deceased, who'd been a Newsweek Washington correspondent, close friend of Ben Bradley's, been Howard Baker's deputy in the White House, and really good guy. And Jim was at the end of his career. They'd made him chairman or something of this Eisenhower Centennial. So we met in Abilene for the first time. And the trip from Abilene back to the Kansas City airport was very long. At least, you know, it's a lovely landscape, but there's an awful lot of it, is how I would how I would characterize the state. And fortunately, we filled the whole time with Cannon's Rockefeller stories, because he had spent several years on the governor's staff and was, in fact, the point man for revenue sharing, something I understand Kansas could use some of at the moment. But in any event, I'm sorry. don't take it personally. In any event, Jim Cannon was a great guy, and he had wonderful stories. So in a sense, this book was born in 1989. It just got around to being finalized with a contract and a shockingly low advance in 14 years ago. I tell people I got $50,000 advance. Now that sounds like a lot, except when you try living for 14 years and you're doing all your research in New York City and thereabouts, you know. So, but, you know, fortunately, I was in a position to be my own funding source.
Yeah, it seems like, you know, I knew about this from the very beginning of taking this job because Linda Kay, who's with us. Well, Linda Kay, where are you? Right here. Who typed the entire manuscript and everything else.
And you didn't just type it. This is a 721-page text that doesn't include over 2,000 footnotes. And no part of this manuscript went through fewer than 50 drafts, which suggests what a heroic or foolhardy role this woman plays.
Yes. Well, you know Richard and me as directors of the Dole Institute, but Linda Kay really ran the place. So, but tell us about your craft a little bit before we get to Rockefeller. I mean, 14 years, you kept finding new material. You told me when you visited, oh gosh, I found all this new stuff.
Well, you have to remember that the Rockefeller papers are enormous, and they were being opened as I was writing. At one point, relatively, everything is relative on this project, after maybe 2 years, I had 70,000 words written, and I'd taken the story up through up to World War II. The age of 32, he's put in charge of Latin America by Franklin Roosevelt, who, by the way, tells him, if you change your party, you could be a president someday. Advice Harry Truman reiterated. But anyway, so I've got 70,000 words, and I'm patting myself on the back, thinking, well, you know, maybe we'll come close. The original pub date was 2006. Then the archives opened a collection within the collection, 125 boxes of paper marked family and friends. Well, this was the good stuff. I mean, this was gold. And I very quickly stumbled upon 100 or more letters written by the first Mrs. Rockefeller to Nelson during their courtship. Now, they were both too young, and they both acknowledged that later. He was married a week after he graduated from Dartmouth. And the correspondence, it's funny, it's impressive in many ways, but it's also sad, it's poignant, because you know what's coming. And because Todd harbored some ambivalence about her own feelings, but I think more about his. Mary Todd Hunter Clark Rockefeller, of the main line, was, according, I found her passport, and it said she was 6'1 and weighed 110 pounds. Yeah, so she was terribly insecure about her attractiveness. And of course, here's this Rockefeller, you know, who is pursuing her. And she had a wonderful sense of humor, which was one of the things that attracted him. But she also had clearly some real insight into people. And she writes him this letter at one point saying, I don't know whether we're in love or not, but all I do know is I don't want to be hurt. She says, if a year after we were married, you were to come to me and tell me you'd fallen in love with some pretty young woman, it would break my heart. And I often say, if this was a Hitchcock movie, the audience would be shouting at the screen, don't go in that room, because you know what's coming. They were married in 1930, had a year, their honeymoon was a year trip around the world. Mahatma Gandhi greeted them in India. Anyway, it went on and on. I mean, you can imagine what a Rockefeller honeymoon was like. And they got back and they had 5 children in 8 years, including twins. And as soon as the twins were born in 1938, Nelson got his friend, Wally Harrison, the architect, to build him a guest house 500 feet from the house at Pocantico. Pocantico is the little village 30 miles north of New York where John D. Rockefeller Sr. First rusticated and eventually built a 4,000-acre estate. And it's a compound. There are a number of family homes. And the big house is called Kijket, which is Dutch for lookout. It's on the top of the hill overlooking the Hudson. Anyway, Nelson and his family lived in a Dutch colonial where George Washington was said to have slept at the time of the Battle of White Plains. But after 8 years into the marriage, he built a guest house, and then he moved into it. He took all his meals with his family, and he slept in the guest house, a permanent guest in his own guest house. And for all practical purposes, the marriage was over. They stayed married for another 23 years. And then at the end of 1961, stunned the world. The Newsweek said the only thing more surprising would have been if Rockefeller had declared bankruptcy. But stunned people, except those who knew them well, and their children, who I don't think ever forgave Nelson, by announcing that they were going to be divorced. And two days, of just the gods were angered. 2 days after that announcement was made, while everyone was still trying to calculate the political consequences, because at that point, there was little doubt Nelson Rockefeller was assumed to be the Republican nominee in 1964. 2 days later, he gets a call from the Dutch ambassador to the United States. His youngest son, Michael, the one child he was really close to, the one who was really like him, the one who he was already training to be president of what they call Mother's Museum, the Museum of Modern Art, started by Abby Aldrich Rockefeller. Michael was missing in New Guinea on an art collecting expedition. He was never found, and to this day, you know, no one really knows what happened. And I talked to Happy Rockefeller, who could not have been kinder. At the beginning of our interview, she said, you know, I don't give interviews. I said, I know, I've been trying for 2 years to get to see you. And we talked about a lot of things, including things that must have been painful for her. And she said, I asked once about Nelson's religious faith. And she said, when he came back from New Guinea, he said, I hope Michael meets Mother in heaven. Which tells you all you need to know. So, you know, it was a life not without tragedy and a good deal of pain. you know, unfortunately, much of it inflicted on others. 14 years obviously is a long time, but it took me 14 years not just to assemble the facts. That's the least part of biography. It took 14 years, first of all, to grow out of that youthful, unquestioning admiration, and then not to go so far in the other extreme as to become a cynic, just to demonstrate to people objectivity. So that took a while. As Linda knows, it took a while because stylistically, you know the oldest line of the book, you work your head off to make something look effortless, you know? But beyond that, as more and more information became available, I think I had more and more unusual insights. We all think of him as someone who spent his whole life thinking about nothing but becoming president. That's Richard Nixon. Nelson Rockefeller, it can be suggested, had too many outside interests. Collecting art meant much more to him than collecting delegates. He never grasped the difference between a November campaign, which in those days meant for a Republican to win, you had to win over enough Democrats and independents, particularly New York, the home of the New Deal. He never grasped the difference between that, which everyone agrees he could have won, except of 64, had he been given the opportunity, and a convention campaign. He did not, I think, appreciate the fact that the Republican Party, as early as 1960, was already mutating away from the old moderate to liberal Eastern establishment, which was in effect a reaction to the New Deal. Almost some would say defensive. What do we have to do? How much of this do we have to accommodate? Well, the Goldwater people were not in a mood to accommodate. And in many, many ways, and I say this without rancor or particularly opinion one way or the other, in many ways, I think the Goldwater movement foreshadows the Tea Party of today. It certainly foreshadows where the Republican Party is compared to, say, when Gerald Ford and Bob Dole were running against a conservative challenger in Ronald Reagan in 1976. All of that helps to explain why he was so polarizing then and why I think he's so relevant today. He certainly died a man without a party, and it's easy to write him off as a dinosaur. But guess what? There are millions of Americans today who feel as if they don't have a party, who believe with him that pragmatism and problem solving should take precedence over ideological purity. So in a lot of ways, if you look beyond the obvious, which is another reason it took 14 years, I found he was not a self-revealing or reflective man. His father used to say, never show more surface than necessary. His daughter Mary said, I only wish we, referring to her family, knew him as well as the voters of New York do. But of course the voters of New York only knew what he wanted them to know. This back-slapping, blintz-eating, tax-raising force of nature. All of which was true, but it's only a small piece of the truth. Early in the process, someone who knew him well said, or what passed for well, said he was a 16-slice pizza pie and only happy had access to more than two or three slices. In the end, the biggest single reason it took me 14 years was to get to the point where I think I know 10 or 11 of the 16 slices. And a lot of it goes against the grain. This was a man who actually harbored self-doubts about his capacity to be president. Happy said to me, I don't know how much he really wanted to be president. She said, because every time he got close, he went and did something stupid, like marry me. Beyond that, it's clear to me he was mesmerized by Franklin Roosevelt. At a very early age, he learned politics at the feet of the master. And I think at the end of his life, he looked upon Roosevelt as the man who had saved Democratic with a small d capitalism. I think he felt himself very much in that tradition of Theodore Roosevelt, Franklin Roosevelt, rich men with a vested interest in effect in the capitalist system, but who understood the dangers of the inequities, injustices, if not reformed in advance, might be leading to revolution. And that, in a nutshell, I think explains where he was coming from, but it's a 14-year nutshell.
Mm-hmm. Talk a little bit about, Richard, talk a little bit about his decision to run for governor and what he accomplished as governor, kind of what he's known for.
Yeah, well, he had been in the Eisenhower, he had been in the Roosevelt White House, he'd been in the Truman White House, and he'd been in the Eisenhower White House. It's a career that would not happen. I mean, I suppose David Gergen could lay claim to some of it, but today it wouldn't happen. And he boasted about the fact that he'd worked on a bipartisan way with presidents of three parties. But what he learned was interesting. He thought government was too reactive. It wasn't preventive. It wasn't anticipatory. One of the first things he did when he became governor, in 1958, he ran against Averell Harriman, who was a nice enough gentleman, but a real stiff. I mean, dull and ducal and remote. And Rockefeller ran rings around him. A liberal columnist in the New York Post gave some advice to Governor Harriman. He came up with a wonderful campaign slogan, because Harriman was worth $75 million. And the campaign slogan was, "Don't change multimillionaires in the middle of a stream." Well, the voters of New York overwhelmingly did. And what made it stand out, 1958 was a disaster for Republicans, much as the recent elections were for the Democrats. And only two people that year sort of breasted the tide. One was the new, attractive, telegenic governor of New York, and the other was Barry Goldwater, who won re-election in Arizona. So Rockefeller becomes governor of New York. He's 50 years old. It's the first time he's ever run for office. Something else happened when he was 50. He had, all his life, had an undiagnosed case of dyslexia. He never heard the word until he was 50 years old. He went through life believing that he had a deficient IQ. His mother said, "Surround yourself with people who are smarter than you," which he did, which worked two ways. It meant a phenomenal appreciation for expertise, for talent. Henry Kissinger being the most notable Rockefeller discovery. But it also meant, in some critical regard, that whatever self-doubt he harbored was exacerbated, because he'd bought all this talent, and the temptation was to listen to all of it, seemingly at the same time. So instead of listening to his gut, which in the end, particularly if you're running for president, needs to be the final arbiter of everything, he allowed himself to almost be overwhelmed by this storehouse of talent that he happened to be able to afford, and that in some ways grew out of his mother's advice. He becomes governor of New York. He names 40 task forces, not to avoid problems, as is the custom today, but to anticipate and document and prepare legislation to deal with New York's problems through the end of the 20th century. So there were task forces on how to increase milk production and what the state's electricity needs might be, and of course, one that led to his ill-fated campaign to legislate that every New Yorker must build a fallout shelter. He actually got the legislature to pass a modified version of this. This is the height of the Cold War. I was astonished. I found a poll in 1959 that showed 2/3 of all Americans expected a nuclear exchange within 2 years. His pragmatic, practical approach was, first of all, he believed that nuclear war could be survived, and that if we built enough civil defense into our system, in fact, it would act as a deterrent to the Soviet Union from launching a first strike. Well, you know, it seemed like a good idea at the time. History has not been very kind. That's the flip side of Rockefeller, what I call a serial alarmist. In the 1930s, he was warning us about Nazi infiltration into Latin America. You know, and then in the 1940s, likewise, campaigning for the war. In the 50s, he went to Eisenhower, true story, at the end of a 10-year review, preview. Every year, there'd be a top-secret meeting in which the president and his military brass would get together and project, based on the latest expertise, Soviet military capacities 10 years out. So how would the United States have to respond? And of course, this was the time when, of course, both sides had the bomb, but it was just now that the Soviets were beginning to build bombers that were capable, long-distance bombers, ICBMs. In other words, they were building the delivery systems that 10 years down the road would make them a much more formidable first-strike danger. And Nelson, of course, goes into full Paul Revere mode, except, you know, the one he's crying danger to is Dwight Eisenhower, who knows something about military strategy himself. And he pulled Ike out of the meeting, and Nelson lacked calibration. He tells Ike that he has to go on TV and warn the people and tell them about the sacrifices that they're going to have to make for years to come. You know, put the nation on a full Cold War footing, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And Eisenhower responds, "Why do I always have to be the one to take the bad news to the people?" Well, Nelson thought of saying, "Because you ran for the job," but for once he bit his tongue. The Eisenhower-Rockefeller relationship is one of the what might have beens in a life full of those. I mean, they should have been allies. They should have been, but the chemistry just was never right. In 1964, again, when the campaign in California was going badly, Ike spent winters out in Palm Springs. And Eisenhower used to say of Rockefeller that he borrowed too many brains to use his own. Rockefeller retorted that Ike was the biggest freeloader in America because he took all sorts of gifts for the farm at Gettysburg. Indeed, on the 10th anniversary of D-Day, in a blatant attempt to curry favor, Nelson Rockefeller found, bought, and transported to the White House the table and chairs used in the planning of the D-Day invasion. Well, you know, that's quite a gift. Didn't get him anything with Eisenhower. Eisenhower accepted the gifts, but he couldn't be bought. That's the difference. Anyway, so at one point in California, Stu Spencer, you know, groping for a strategy, says, "Hey, you know, Ike's out there. Why don't we get some pictures of the two of you?" And Nelson says, "Ah, forget it. That guy hates my guts." And eventually, friends brought them together, and the pictures were unusable. And Nelson just said, "I told you, that guy hates my guts." And that's sort of where that relationship went. They disagreed, again, over the pace of American military spending. Ike, remember, after Sputnik, everyone went crazy. The Rockefeller Brothers report on military preparedness was used by John F. Kennedy throughout 1960 to buttress his charges of a missile gap. Well, we now know there was no missile gap. In fact, probably the Rockefellers did more than anyone to instill a sense of national paranoia about our military. And Ike, on the other hand, and he took a lot of criticism at the time, you know, one thing presidents get criticized for, and history tends to reward them, is for not doing things that may seem to be popular at the time. And only Dwight Eisenhower, with his unmatched military credentials, could have gotten away with trying to damp down the hysteria that followed on Sputnik. And I must say, it's not one of Nelson's finest moments. I think he would have, that's why I don't think 1960, it's the year he could have won. The Kennedys said if the Republicans had nominated him in 60, he would have won. But I think he was too young, too green, and too unrestrained in his military views. 68, I think he would have been a great president. After he lost the Republican nomination that year, Hubert Humphrey asked him to be his vice president in a government of national unity. And if you remember, in 1968, we didn't have a lot of that. And Rockefeller, he couldn't bring himself to leave the party of his father and grandfather, and he certainly couldn't bring himself to accept the vice presidency, which he was offered three times. Once by Richard Nixon in 1960, by Humphrey, and then again by Gerald Ford.
Why did Ford turn to him?
It made a lot of sense at the time. Remember, Gerald Ford was a man who had spent his lifetime on Capitol Hill. He wasn't terribly well known when he became president. He certainly was not well known around the world. Nelson Rockefeller represented, first of all, unparalleled experience in the executive branch as governor of New York. He had a global reputation. He had access to a seemingly limitless talent warehouse. And again, Ford, for all he knew, was going to have to repopulate the Nixon White House. Ford had worked closely with Rockefeller on a Rockefeller commission. Ford and Rockefeller had worked on revenue sharing. So he had, plus Ford was a guy who was always comfortable in his own skin. It never occurred to him to be uncomfortable having a Rockefeller, on the ticket. At the time, Nelson told himself, and it's true, but it's not the whole truth, that he said yes because the country was in a constitutional crisis and the president needed his help. He said, I've known every vice president since Henry Wallace. They were all miserable. He thought he could be different. Now, what he didn't acknowledge, I talked to several people who tried to persuade him not to do it. People who knew him well, knew his temperament. He'd always said, I'm not made out to be standby equipment. Ford himself said the vice presidency was the worst job he ever had. So he started out with sympathy for Rockefeller, but someone spent 20 minutes chapter and verse telling Nelson why he shouldn't be vice president. And he listened politely. He said, look, everything you said makes perfect sense, but you're leaving out one thing. This is as close as I'm ever going to get. By 1976, he was 68, and it was as close as he was ever going to get. In fact, the closest he ever came to becoming president was when Squeaky Fromm took a pot shot at President Ford. Of course, remember, she was part of the Manson gang. When he was told the news and explained this, Nelson's only reaction was, what's a Manson gang? So he went into the vice presidency with a misconception of what it could be, and it sends a misconception of what his own motives were. And he was even more miserable. There, some people, Nelson Rockefeller and Don Rumsfeld, were put on this earth to piss each other off. Dick Cheney helped out. And you cannot exaggerate. So I'll tell a humorous story. It got so bad that it sounds implausible. It is implausible, but life is implausible. And someone who was there swears it happened. Nelson believed that Rumsfeld wanted to replace him on the ticket. He blamed Rumsfeld for his being booted from the ticket in 75. Thereafter, played the good soldier. In fact, he delivered the delegates that put Ford over the top, even after being booted from the ticket. The one thing he asked in return was that Donald Rumsfeld not be at the convention. And for whatever reason, Rumsfeld was not there. But the funny thing is, it got so bad, Nelson in the morning, he'd get to work early, and he'd walk by Rumsfeld's office in the West Wing, open the door, poke his head in, and shout to no one in particular, Rummy, you're never going to be vice president, and go on his way. Rumsfeld, by the way, denies that it happened. But in any event, the sad thing, the last night of the convention, And here's the Dole story. He played an integral role in the events that produced Bob Dole on the ticket. I personally now am convinced, after this, that Gerald Ford's initial preference was for William Ruckelshaus. But Ford, of course, being a man of the Hill and seeking consensus, brought the usual, you know, and unusual suspects together, and they talked all night, went through a number of possibilities. Howard Baker was certainly prominent, and there were others as well. The name of Anne Armstrong was mentioned, would have been the first woman. Anyway, they broke around dawn, and they still hadn't decided. And a Rockefeller, top Rockefeller aide, a man named George Hinman, who was on the National Committee, tipped off Nelson that some Southern delegates had come to him and said, "We want Reagan. But if Reagan won't do it, Bob Dole would be acceptable." And Rockefeller passed that word on to Ford. And within a half hour, the deal was done. And you had the Ford-Dole ticket. Okay. Nelson goes back to his hotel room, which is just down the hall from President Ford's. He's exhausted. He hasn't really slept in 3 days. And his osteopath, who is Exhibit A in the fact that really rich people get really lousy medical care, he put him to bed. While he's sleeping, word comes over from the Ford campaign, the president wants Nelson to nominate Dole that evening. Well, more good soldiering. So while he sleeps, the staff says yes, and they prepare a speech. And with the dyslexia, he had to allocate extra time to, you know, the most famous. He wanted universal health insurance on the state level for every New Yorker. And he goes to an audience, and of course, his eyes would play tricks with numbers. So he gets up in front, this is 1967. He gets up in front of a sort of working class audience, and he says, "Now imagine you're a typical family of four making $100,000 a year." Well, that's the reaction he got. Of course, the paper said 10,000, but eyes played tricks. Anyway, so he goes over the speech, doesn't change a word. Then all hell breaks loose. He gets to the hall, he delivers a speech, and for some reason, the microphones go dead while he's speaking. People can't hear him, and he, at this point, is imagining the worst. And he, you know, boils and boils. And then anyway, the president delivers his speech, Reagan comes down, gives what would have been his acceptance speech, and they're all ready for the tableau, as I say, the manger in Bethlehem scene, where everyone lines up with an artificial look of satisfaction on their face. In the case of Rockefeller, it was particularly artificial, because before they go up, he was a stickler for protocol. It's curious. You know, the president goes up and the vice president goes up. He says, "Okay, what's the plan?" And he is informed that his role for the evening is to escort Bob Dole's mother. He's not going up after the president. And he loses it. Not because he had anything against Bob Dole's mother. He just nominated her son. But it was one of those little things. It was a tripwire. And all the resentments and frustrations poured out. And he saw Dick Cheney. And in his later years, when he got very angry, really angry, he would take two fingers and punch. And it was like a fist. He was a tough guy. And I'm surprised Dick Cheney didn't have a heart attack there. because Nelson pushed him hard enough. And Cheney, who's, you know, kind of babbling, "I'm sorry, I didn't," blah, blah, blah. And Lynn Cheney is in tears, which is not something you imagine happens very often. So it must have been a horrible scene. And there are all these people around watching. And he went up, put the smile on, pretended everything was fine, went back to his room. President Ford said, "I want to see you." And he went and he said, "I'm not going to Vail. I'm not going to, I'm done, I'm through. I got you the nomination." I mean, it was bad. And anyway, series of back and forth followed. Eventually he relented, he went to Vail. He was not involved in the campaign, and his political career was over. Not a high note to go out on. He, after the election, I'm pleased to say, the President, Mrs. Ford, came and spent a weekend at Pocatello. And I think a lot of wounds were healed. And Gerald Ford later said publicly, more than once, and I know I heard him say it privately, that dumping Rockefeller was the one act of cowardice in his political life that he regretted. On the other hand, to be fair, it's really questionable whether if he'd kept Rockefeller, he could have won the nomination. I mean, Rockefeller had become such a lightning rod.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it wasn't even anything in particular that people, one quick thing, because we think of him as an inconsequential vice president, certainly an unhappy vice president. What did he accomplish? Two things. Because of his rulings from the chair, again, dyslexic, he had Richard Parsons, later chairman of Citicorp, someone you may be familiar with, Richard Parsons, African-American surrogate son, and brilliant. And he sat up in the Senate gallery with his chart directing the vice president which way to go. If Strom Thurmond raised this objection or Barry Goldwater raised this objection. And in the end, because of Nelson Rockefeller, the threshold for breaking the filibuster was lowered from 67 to 60. Now that may not seem like much today when 60 seems unattainable. He did it because of the same reason he let people know, including the White House, that he supported extension of the Voting Rights Act. He had never lost his continuing, genuine interest in, and I'd say passionate, support of civil rights. And a number of conservative Republican senators, including Thurmond and John Tower of Texas, went down to the White House and told the president, you better get your vice president on board. And Parsons is convinced that's what began the process leading to Rockefeller being dumped from the ticket in 75. And the beginning of Bob Dole's national career.
You've talked, Richard, about the aide who described Rockefeller's life as a 16-slice pizza. We haven't been
he
able to get
He didn't say whether it was pepperoni or sausage.
Okay. We haven't been able to get into too many slices today. We just don't have the time. But, you know, we've covered a lot of ground, but what would you say Rockefeller's essence was? What's his place in American history?
Nelson Rockefeller was of that classic American strain. He thought every problem had a solution. Utterly. You couldn't persuade him to the contrary. And it's been a long time since we had that kind of simple, if you will, faith in our capacity. Of course, remember, he's coming out of a generation, not that it affected him, but he's coming out of a generation that had overcome the Depression and the Dust Bowl, that had defeated the Nazis, that was holding off the Soviet Union through a sustained bipartisan effort called the Cold War, that had pledged to put a man on the moon by the end of the 1960s. It's not surprising that he was an optimist, but in his case, it went beyond that. And I think he was also a good-hearted. Hubert Humphrey took a lot of heat in 68 for talking about the politics of joy. Nelson and Humphrey had a lot in common, temperamentally. They would have made a great ticket. I mean, it's fascinating what might have happened. But there's no doubt Nelson Rockefeller went through life incredibly aware of all that had been given to him and his family. And he believed that just as they had a moral obligation to give back to the country, he believed the United States was in much the same position, that it had also been favored by God, had been extraordinarily endowed in many, many ways, and had a credo, had a faith, a belief. There was no one who was more militant in his anti-communism. There was no one who was more sentimental When Lincoln Center was dedicated in 1962, Jackie Kennedy was the guest of honor. And you can imagine, I mean, everyone else showed up. And in the Philharmonic Hall, when the orchestra played the Star Spangled Banner, it was noted that only one person sang along. That was the governor of New York. I mean, you could almost call it corny, but he was an old-fashioned patriot. And that combined with this uncomplicated, he was complicated, but his faith in the country and its values and what it had to offer the rest of the world was uncomplicated. And I think that's a pretty attractive combination. I think today the divorce and remarriage would have meant much less. I think, put it this way, it would not have been fatal in the sense that it was fatal in 1963. I don't think it's why he never became president. I think factors beyond his control, timing, temperament. His problem was he was in the wrong party. And I mean that philosophically. He believed the way to become, it's almost an aristocratic concept. He believed the way to become president was to demonstrate a genius for governing, which he did in New York State, a very tough stage on which to operate. The problem was he was in a political party that even then was beginning to look upon government as the threat, not the solution. Civil rights was another divisive factor, but he never wavered in his support. So you may question his taste in art. His press secretary, it's funny, when he became governor, out went Averill Harriman's Gilbert Stuart portraits. And in their place went Picasso and Pollock and Mondrian and Motherwell. His press secretary said, I don't think the American people are ready to elect a president who collects modern art. The members of the New York legislature suggested that the governor's paintings be referred to the Select Committee on Pornography, which tells you something about the cultural sophistication of the New York legislature. And he thought it was awful. He thought it was very funny. It was amusing. But a key to, he thought he could have art on his own terms. When you went to visit him at his 34-room triplex apartment on Fifth Avenue, you were blown away by the art that cluttered. And he was out of walls, he said. Been out of walls for years. Had five homes. The fireplace in the living room was painted by Matisse. The andirons were done by the Giacometti brothers, who by the way, his recent sculpture was sold for $1.6 million. Mark Hatfield told me the story. After he had been given the grand tour by Nelson, he'd never seen anything like this, never in a museum. And he said, Nelson, I have to ask you, of all your collections, which one gives you the most pleasure? He said, oh, Mark, that's easy, it's my china. He said, sometimes I get up in the middle of the night just to set the table. An artist who shall remain nameless sold him at no cheap price a large metal sculpture. If you visit Pocarnico, if you have a chance, if you're in New York, take a day, go up the river, it's a beautiful ride, go to Pocarnico, and there are 70 pieces of the governor's sculpture collection that are still out there where he placed them. He should have been a curator. He had a remarkable eye for things. Anyway, there's this very large sculpture, and the first thing he did after he bought it was red, and he repainted it black. And word got back to the artist who said, you know, what gave him the right to think he could repaint my sculpture? An understandable reaction from an artist. And Rockefeller said, if he didn't want me to repaint it, why the hell did he sell it to me? On his own terms.
We're going to open it up to audience questions after one more. So if you've got one in mind, be thinking about it. And raise your hand and let one of our student workers bring a mic by. But Richard, I want to ask you briefly, what's next for you?
Back to the Future. It's Gerald Ford. In 1 month, Probably the worst time of year to move, especially to Western Michigan. I shall be moving to Western Michigan, back to Grand Rapids, where for six very happy years, I was director of the Ford Museum. And I have, the next 5 years, have been blocked out to write, hopefully, a definitive biography of the 38th president. It's not been done. It's time to do it. I don't know if I was the person born to do it, but I'm the person who's going to be doing it. And in some ways, it's such a logical conclusion to a career that's, sort of began with Tom Dewey. I'm tracing the decline and fall of liberal republicanism. there are worse things to put on your business card, Tracer of decline, and obviously I was blessed. I had a chance to become close to the Fords personally, so I feel like this is a chance to give back. Although I understand, for the book to have any credibility at all, it's also going to have to be critical. So, but it won't be 14 years.
So we can expect you back to talk about that book before 2028 then, right? Okay, let's do questions. Let's start here.
Hi, I'm Rob Schofield, and I grew up in the state capitol in Albany and knew Nelson Rockefeller.
Before the mall.
My mother was the secretary for his lieutenant governor, Malcolm Wilson. So we have a family portrait with Nelson Rockefeller and with Lieutenant Governor Wilson. My question is about the Rockefeller children, who I also have met. I did not know well, obviously. Speak to that, because you don't hear of them. I mean, if they're in the limelight, they're sure under the radar. Thank you.
And that's by choice. There are two families, of course. Nelson and Todd had five children. I mentioned Michael, who passed away in 1961. There was a tension in the family because Todd was a very private woman, and she passed that on to her children. All five of the Rockefeller children have the same middle name, Clark, which gives you some idea of the dynamics within that family. And it's fair to say that of the five children, all but perhaps Michael gravitated very much more toward their mother's sort of temperament when it came to publicity and the like. And then, of course, Happy, his second wife, had two boys. I tell you, it ages you immeasurably to realize lots of people think the California primary was lost at the last minute when Nelson Jr. was born the weekend before the primary, which, of course, reminded everyone about the divorce and remarriage. What I found, to my mild astonishment and horror, was some of those people supposedly smarter than Nelson in the campaign in New York wanted, if necessary, the birth of the baby to be induced before the primary, because they got it in their heads, God knows where, that being a family man would be an asset for Nelson. And of course, it was exactly the opposite. I mean, I talked to people in the campaign who got phone calls a week out. How would you feel if Nelson Jr. was born before the primary? And said, oh my God, do anything. Push him back, do anything to make sure this doesn't happen. But I tell you, it does age one to learn that last June, Nelson Jr. turned 50. His brother, Mark, is like 3 years younger. They're both married, have children, doing well. Nelson is the spitting image of his father. He walked into a room and it's Nelson reincarnated. I mean, he works a room, usually had a couple blondes, on his arms. And it's just amazing. And people have been urging him for years to go into politics. I would think being born with that name, it's interesting. When Todd and Nelson had their very first child, everyone assumed they were going to name him Nelson. And they, on their own, said, absolutely not. He was named Rodman. Rodman died several years ago. So Three of the children from the first marriage are still around, two daughters and a son. And they declined to see me, but they were well aware of this. And in fact, the son was helpful enough to provide me with a lengthy edited transcript of an oral history that he had done. And they all had to give their approval for their pictures to be used in the book. And they did, as did Happy. And I did talk to both of the boys, Mark and Nelson. And I think they're at the age where I think they actually enjoyed finding out, you know, hearing stories about their dad. So that's why we haven't heard more from them.
Okay, we have a question here.
Thanks for coming. Would you comment a little bit about the aftermath of the New York prison riots and if that affected how Rockefeller viewed governance or governing?
It certainly affected how people viewed Rockefeller. On the left today, he is pilloried for the Rockefeller drug laws, which everyone agrees were punitive, and Attica. The chapter on Attica was the most difficult for me to write. It's also the one, frankly, I'm proudest of, because it incorporates a vast amount of new information, and it, I think, does justice to conflicting sides of the story. What happened, in a nutshell, in my opinion, is that people over the years have conflated two things. Throughout the takeover, if you remember, in September of 1971, several hundred, eventually over 1,000 inmates at Attica State Correctional Facility took the prison, and 43 or thereabouts hostages, mostly guards. And for 3 days, there were negotiations, which today is very difficult to explain. It's a Paddy Chayefsky movie. They brought in TV cameras. They brought in outside observers who were nothing of the sort. William Kunstler was many things, but he was not an observer. He was a partisan with a very pronounced point of view. It's very, very, very much a reflection of the radicalism of the early 70s. Not what went on in the prison, but what went on outside. And it's difficult to communicate to people today what seems implausible at best. But for most of that time, Nelson wasn't part of the story. He was at Proconico following on the phone his state corrections commissioner, a reformer named Russell Oswald, was in charge of all this. He had convinced himself that he could negotiate a peaceful solution. Then, on the third night, a guard died who had been brutalized in the initial takeover. And all of a sudden, the issue became amnesty. And everything changed in a minute. During the day, they had actually found, and the governor had signed on to a reform plan, it's called the 28 points, all suggestions by inmates for improving conditions, which, by the way, no one can defend. Then everything changed, and the pressure, the observers realizing their mission was failing, switched the game. It all became about bringing the governor. The governor has to come. The governor has to be part of this. And what people have conflated over the years is Rockefeller's refusal to go, which he insisted was a point of principle. You can argue all sorts of things. It can be argued both ways. They conflated that with the terribly botched retaking of the prison that occurred the next day, where 43 people died, prisoners and guards. And the state made it worse. Rockefeller made it worse by rushing out with statements before all the information was in. It turned out that everyone died really because of the bullets, the hail fusillade of bullets from the state. So it was a disaster. And in some ways, his reputation, you know, in some quarters, has never recovered. But as I say, he thought if he went, he would have established a precedent that, first of all, they would insist that he come into the yard and negotiate with them. And when that was unsatisfactory, they'd want the president. You know, et cetera, et cetera. You know, and again, you can argue it all ways. I think for PR purposes, and I'm not making light for a moment of the seriousness of the situation, I think he should have gone. I think if he was really interested in political advantage, he would have gone. He wouldn't have stayed at Pocarnico. And also, if he had gone, I think he would have seen with his own eyes the mood, the incredible hostility, the anger that was building up among those who would be entrusted with taking back the prison. I mean, the next day, everything that could go wrong went wrong. And had he gone, one, he might have delayed the retaking. At least he would have owned it in a way that he did anyway. The most poignant aspect of that is memory. In 1914, there was the Ludlow Massacre in Colorado, where a Rockefeller company broke a strike, bringing in the National Guard. Several people were killed subsequently. John D. Rockefeller Jr., the governor's father, had tried to distance himself. I think Nelson saw history repeating itself. He went through the rest of his life giving the impression that what had happened, you know, that he was hardened to what had happened. The fact is he was haunted the rest of his life by what had happened. The next day, a friend saw him and complimented him on his tie. And Rockefeller said, "Oh, you're red, the hangman's color." Which is a small but telling instance, for one, of why it took 14 years, and two, of how in many, many respects, Rockefeller historically would be better served had he been less, had he followed the family code of privacy. You know, he paid for Martin Luther King's funeral. He organized the funeral. He sent his best advance men down to Atlanta, half an hour. He talked after the death of Dr. King. He was on the phone to Mrs. King, "What can I do?" And they found the mule-drawn wagon. They picked out the casket. They took Dr. King's children to see their father lying in state at Spelman College, founded by the Rockefellers, to educate black women in the 19th century. And he insisted that none of it be made public because he didn't want to take advantage of the family's suffering. 2 months later, he did the same thing when Bobby Kennedy was killed. Helped out, you know. So there's a lot of things we didn't know. Undoubtedly, there are things we still don't know. But I think silence has not served him well.
Okay, we have a question here.
Can you talk a little bit more about how Nelson viewed his role as a Rockefeller, his family's legacy, and what it meant to him to be a Rockefeller?
Yeah, he wasn't a Rockefeller, he was the Rockefeller. In a nutshell, that's how he viewed his role. He was one of five children, six children. It's awful, I overlooked the daughter, Abby, who was the first child, and who unfortunately at that age, was in that era, was never really, you know, given the opportunity to succeed on a level with her brothers, but there were five brothers. When Junior died in May of 1960, I talked to the woman at Riverside Church in New York, which is the Rockefeller Church. Junior built it across the street from Grant's tomb. Junior was a modernist. He was as modern in his religion as Abby was in her art. If you go to Riverside Church, the gargoyles and the sculptures are not of saints, but scientists. So Albert Einstein and George Washington Carver, you know, and others are there. It's a window into Junior's soul. But anyway, when he died in 1960, there was a memorial service. The Rockefellers always have a memorial service at Riverside. And afterwards, they had the obligatory group photo with the five brothers. Interesting, the brothers lined up. Well, Nelson showed up, and of course, rearranged the photo to put himself in the middle. And that, in a nutshell, sadly, if you read David Rockefeller's memoir, he told Bill Scranton, who was his neighbor up at Bar Harbor, who told me the hardest thing about writing the book was writing honestly about Nelson. David, I don't think, ever forgave Nelson for the divorce and remarriage, because they were very good friends with Dr. Murphy, and then Happy Murphy. And John III, the oldest of the sons, who was born with that name and all that went with it, but who was very diffident, very shy, never had the personality to project himself into the public, and was horrified at Nelson going into politics. John III and Nelson did not speak for the last 6 months of John III's life. He died in an auto accident 6 months before Nelson's death. So, like any family, there were strains and tensions, but it's very clear that, you know, Nelson saw himself as the Rockefeller. And quite frankly, he was right. His brother Lawrence, I interviewed Lawrence when he was 91. I went to room 5600, which is the Rockefeller office at top what I will always call the RCA building. And it's amazing. I had interviewed David Rockefeller 20 years earlier for my book on Tom Dewey, and he was certainly very pleasant, but not the warmest. Small talk was not his major. That's fine, you know. Before I saw him, there are minions who take you to minions. It's like going to see the Wizard of Oz, you know. And Lawrence, on the other hand, to my astonishment, with his cane, met me at the elevator. And I was surprised. I said, "Oh, Mr. Rockefeller." He said, "Now, Richard," puts his hand on my shoulder. We're on a first name basis. And he led me back into what had been Nelson's office. This is 25 years after Nelson's death. Been left exactly as it was. It's next to Lawrence's office. And the story was, Lawrence every day at lunch would have lunch in Nelson's office and commune with his brother's spirit. They were joined at the hip. They were life. Lawrence was probably the closest thing Nelson had to a friend, a lifelong friend. And then David was the youngest, Winthrop, who of course became governor of Arkansas. Nelson, when Winthrop died in 1973, Nelson did the eulogy in Arkansas, and he said beforehand, "I'll never be able to get through this." He said, "You don't understand." He said, "I'm responsible for a lot of Winthrop's problems." What he meant was, as children can be cruel, he and Lawrence would gang up on Winthrop, whom they dubbed Wissy Wissy, a nickname, needless to say, that did not endear them to Winthrop. And later on, Winthrop had the most expensive divorce in American history to that time, $6 million. And he was hard up for cash, so his brother Nelson lent him $2 million. It's got to be nice to have a brother who can loan you $2 million, you know, in 1950. So, you know, it's the family is in the book, and, you know, they were really interesting people. But in some ways, the normality, you know, like all families, they had their strains and their tensions. It's just on a grander scale.
Okay, we're going to take two more questions. We have one back here and then one here, back in the back.
This is another question kind of on the family, but I recall during the Senate confirmation hearing on Nelson's nomination as vice president, the family had a real issue with having to release his finances. Could you comment on that?
Yeah, I mean, you have to remember, Nelson said later on that during the California primary campaign in 64, he had actually prepared for the first time a complete listing of all his holdings. And then he said no one asked him about it. So it never was released. There's no doubt the confirmation hearings dragged on much longer than anyone expected. And there was great drama behind the scenes because the family was up in arms about the degree of revelation. There were people, I've been talking to Caspar Weinberger, Ronald Reagan's HEW secretary, and earlier a Republican chairman in California, who was a closet Rockefeller Republican in those days. And he said, you know, it was pure financial voyeurism. No one doubted Nelson's qualifications to be vice president, let alone president, but they all wanted to find out how much money he had. The day he was nominated, I talked to the gentleman who was assigned by the White House with the task of getting him, Tom Corlogus, getting him confirmed. And when he was done, the press was done and everything, Tom went up, introduced himself. He said, I'm going to be living with you for the next however many weeks. Explained who he was, what his job was. He said, now, I want you to think. You don't have to tell me, but I want you to think hard if there's anything in your background that could complicate your confirmation, make it harder. And Rockefeller thought, he said, yeah, there is something. And he said, you don't have to, no, he said, that's all right. He said, people are going to find out I'm not worth as much as they think. That was his point of shame, you know? It was only worth $300 million instead of, you know. In the end, there was a very critical juncture where Congressman Mazvinsky from Iowa demanded a complete listing of the financial holdings of every member of the Rockefeller family. And Nelson said, I can't do that. You know, I'll give you everything I own. You know, I have a blind trust. I'll open up anything you want. But I can't do that. It will destroy the family. And they pressed, he said, you don't understand. We've provided unequally for the children. Not only him, but clearly his brothers did not provide the same amount for each of their children. And obviously that was not something they wanted known. So it was something very personal, something that I think everyone can understand. And a compromise was worked out. But he came very close at one point to pulling out. And the family never really forgave him for putting them through the ringer of financial disclosure. And it came back to haunt him. When he came back from Washington, the last 2 years were difficult, in part because he thought he could just step in and take over leadership of the family. And there was a whole new generation called the cousins. And the cousins were determined not to roll over for Uncle Nelson.
Okay, we have time for one last question.
One thing I remember about Nelson Rockefeller is that he was quite influential in helping to establish Williamsburg, Virginia, which I think is a great accomplishment. Would you comment on how that reflects his role
in America? I'm going to slightly correct your recollection, because certainly the Rockefellers established Colonial Williamsburg. His father, John D. Rockefeller Jr., loved Williamsburg. And he created Williamsburg. He put over $80 million into restoring the old colonial capital of Virginia. Nelson, however, got out of the project very early on. And I'll tell you why. He went down there right after he was married with Todd, and they were about to reconstruct the governor's palace, which, if you've seen it, you know was a very impressive reconstruction. They had found the original drawings, the architect's drawings for the palace in a London library. So this was a great find. So Nelson, of course, with that eye, the dyslexic's eye, he looks at these and he sees it's not perfect. There's a stairway slightly off center. And he points it out to his father. He says, we're not reconstructing this as we would want it to be built. We're reconstructing the original. Message delivered. Nelson quits the board, turns it over to his brother John III, who was much more willing to go along with his father's view of, and he said, about that time, he said, you know, I didn't want to sit on a bunch of boards where I wasn't in control and wait until I was 60 years old to inherit a business. You know, I wanted to do what I wanted to do, and I wanted to do it the way I wanted to do it, which is his motto in a lot of ways, and which led to some remarkable accomplishments and some profound disappointments. I guess I should thank you all for not asking about how he died. Maybe everyone's forgotten, you know? But I will tell you, first of all, I'm smart enough to know that lots of people are going to read the last chapter first. But what's important about that night is one thing. First of all, I learned that he was dying. He knew he was dying. It's a very serious heart condition. 2 nights before he died, he said to one of Happy's children that he wasn't afraid to die, but he was sorry to leave everyone. So he had a real sense. She talked to me very candidly about that night. It was just amazing, sitting there in Kaikit. And she said, you know, they'd gone. You know, his mother died, had a wonderful weekend with the family, went back to New York, woke up Monday morning, had a massive heart attack, and was gone. Nelson, Happy thought, did not want to die in front of the children. They had dinner. She said, I heard him pick up the phone and call Megan and meet him at the townhouse. They were working on a contemporary art book. One volume had already been published. This was, they were working against deadline. He put the phone down. He said, the boys are fine. He told her he loved her, and it won't be long now. And 2 hours later, he was dead, amid circumstances that became much more scandalous than they need have been, because Hugh Morrow, the communications director, thinking he would spare Happy embarrassment, standing in the hospital room, or in the hospital, outside the operating room, where Happy and Lawrence Rockefeller are sitting across from Meghan Marchak. You can imagine what that atmosphere must have been like. He's got the press out in the parking lot, baying at the moon, wanting, you know. And so he went out without checking the facts, thinking that he could get away with, in a post-Watergate, in New York City, with, you know, Jimmy Breslin and Anna Quinlan and, you know, who knows who else, eager to rip to shreds, whatever the official story was. And he went out and he tried to cover it up, clumsily, came unraveled over the weekend. Someone who shall remain nameless, one of my very few confidential sources, was the person who was involved in this. Happy Rockefeller called this person over the weekend and said, this must be hell on Meghan. Find a time when none of the family are around at the funeral home so she can pay her respects. And what's important about that night, one, I'm convinced, having spent an absurd amount of time tracking every bit of information down, that nothing that could have been done was left undone. He didn't die because of embarrassment or needlessly. He died because it was his time to die. But what's important about that night, what matters, the one historical thing that matters, is that's the night the American media redefined what is public and what is private about the lives of their public figures. It did not begin with Gary Hart, although you can draw a line directly from Rockefeller's death and the attempted cover-up to Gary Hart. But by then, Pandora was out of her box, and you can get a good debate going on the long run whether it's been a good thing or a bad thing. But it was Nelson's final and least wanted legacy.
Okay, Richard, thank you so much.
Thank you.